Yep.
Okay, so, take a look at that question there, and it says, short answer question two. And this is 2016. So on the 2016 AP test, this was one of the questions. And so it says answer A, B, and C. And so the one that I'm going to give you on Thursday is going to be similar. It'll have three parts, three specific questions, right? Only in the one I'm going to give you on Thursday, you'll have to read two excerpts, you know, before you answer those questions. So I say read these excerpts and then answer these three questions. So here, it's relying upon you just knowing something. You're not reading it. But the one I'm going to give you Thursday, you're going to have to read two excerpts, right? And then there'll be three questions. And they'll be similar to these, right? So question one says, briefly explain how one specific environmental or geographic feature of the New England colonies contributed to the region's unique development before 1754. B. Briefly explain how one specific environmental or geographic feature of the middle colonies contributed to the region's unique development before 1754. C. Briefly explain how one specific environmental or geographic feature of the southern colonies contributed to the region's unique development before 1754. Okay, take a second and think to yourself, if you had to respond to that, right, those three questions, what pops into your mind? Write it down on your paper. Take a second. Okay, you're thinking about geographic or environmental features that influence the development of those colonies. It's okay if you can't think of anything. But if you can't think of anything for all three of those things, we're in trouble. Right? So think about it. Write whatever pops into your mind next to any of those things. Okay? So think about it. Unique geographic or environmental. For each of those three areas, for New England, for the middle colonies, and for the southern colonies. Okay? So think about that a little bit. Write down what pops into your mind. Now, turn to the second page I gave you, which is the 2016 scoring guide. Okay? So now, on the second page that I gave you, the scoring guide, the authors of those questions have come up with some potential responses. So look at A. Right? It says examples of responses that would earn the points. Right? And then you have rocky soil, trees, rolling hills, rivers, whatever. So compare that to what you wrote for A if you wrote anything. So compare that to what you wrote for A. Right? And then B, you can see examples of things that would be earn the point for B. Fertile soil, temperate climate, good harbor, navigable rivers, combination of cities, you know, any reference to tobacco is not necessarily wrong. Okay, then you have it there. And then C, the other things, right? So compare those just quickly to what you may have thought of and wrote down. Now, I would feel comfortable giving you this question on your test on Thursday. And I would feel, you know, I would feel like you should be able to respond to this, right? So, I mean, you haven't studied yet, and, you know, maybe you have, but, I mean, I would feel like you'd have to respond. But I think the question that would be is, how would the format of your response look? If you flip the page to what you see here, and what I'm going to give you on Thursday is a page that looks similar to this. And on the AP, it's the page the AP uses. And what they say is that you can't go outside of that page. You can't write any more than that. And what we're also going to say is the responses that you see here earn the full credit from the AP and would have earned the full credit from me, right? So you can see that these are short answers, right? I mean, you don't get more for, and they are very direct answers. So these, all of these earn the credit, right? Now, all of these responses are two sentences, right? And I would say that's the standard. So when you get that question on Thursday, you should look to respond to it in complete sentences but you'll probably be able to respond to A, B, and C in two sentences. And if you really can't come up with two sentences, just respond in one, right? You know, but I mean, typically, the responses are two sentences. So let's just take a look at one of these, and then you can look at them over. And I mean, like I said, the question itself will actually have a text attached to it. So you'll read the text and you'll know something from reading it, right? You know, so, and then you'll be asked to add, you know, additional questions. But how do you format those responses? Well, look at A, right? Just A, it says, rugged, unformable terrain of New England was an environmental feature in the colonial era that made the region very commercial and manufacturing area. Now that's not even a good sentence, but that's adequate, right? That's adequate because they identified rugged and informal terrain, right? Because the colonists couldn't farm the rough soil, New England became a trading hub where Americans would interact with Europeans and gain products. This made New England a manufacturing outpost of America. Now that is an adequate response, right? So when you get that thing on Thursday, what you want to do is respond in this manner. And so I'm going to give you 2 points for each of them, which is good for you, right? Because then you can get 6 out of 6 fairly easily. Like I said, it's not going to be hard. You don't have to write a lot, but you should adequately respond in, you know, at least a sentence and usually two. But don't kill yourself to find two sentences. This person, they didn't even write good sentences, right? But it's, with the AP and with me, it's either you got it or you don't. The way the AP does, they don't look at the quality of this. I mean, there's other examples that I think are better worded and better done, but it's either you have it or you don't on these short responses, okay? So periodically throughout the year, I'll put these on the test simply because, you know, I want to give you practice because you have to do it on the AP test, right? You know, so that you can see how to do it. You can't go outside of the paper, you know, when you respond, but that shouldn't be a problem. You can see that this person is a small writer. But, you know, they didn't even go anywhere near the way outside of that, right? Okay. So there you go with that. Now, right, now to the rest of the test. Right, so the rest of the test is in a serious situation. The rest of the test, I can't find. Ah, here it is. The rest of the test, right on chapters 1 through 4. Okay. So the first thing that we started to talk about, and the first thing that will be on this test, is contact between the Europeans that came as a result of exploration and the natives that were here. Now, the first thing will be that contact. Now, we talked about in class that pre-Columbian history, but I don't think there's anything really on the test about that pre-Columbian history and man and things of that nature. So the test starts with contact, right? So in terms of that contact, we generally say that the contact between Europeans and Native Americans results in what we refer to as the Columbian Exchange, right? Columbian means Columbus, right? The Columbian Exchange. Now, in terms of the Columbian Exchange, what you are talking about is an exchange of animals, an exchange of plants, to some extent an exchange of ideas, traditions, values, you know, products. But when we talk about the Columbian Exchange, what was the most far-reaching aspect of that exchange that affected the native people the most? Go ahead, Dominic.
Disease.
Right, so there are going to be numerous questions on the test that relate back to the importance of disease in terms of that exchange. Now, if you were to pick one disease, and we really didn't talk about this, but they may reference it, we alluded to this, one disease that was particularly devastating, yes, smallpox, right? Because that's the disease that affected the Aztecs and the Incas with all of those scabs, and was so devastating, wiped out so many people. Remember, man argues that this is why the continent was basically empty, because of disease, right? Now, the Europeans, right, introduced into America a disease as well. And the only disease, they introduced smallpox, they introduced, other diseases as well, the flu, into America. Now, there wasn't much disease that went back out to Europe, because the Indians didn't have those. Now, okay, the first people to come to North America, the first Europeans that come to the Americas in general, were the Spanish. And so there'll be a couple of questions on the test about Spanish colonization, and particularly about the connection between the Spaniards and the Native Americans. What embodies that connection? I mean, what is the relationship between Spanish colonization and the Native Americans? What's your recollection of our conversation about that? I mean, how would you describe the relationship between the Spanish, colonizers and explorers, and the natives that they encountered? What word comes to mind? Go ahead. Yeah, I think conquest would be a word that you would associate with. They conquer these Indians, and then they enslave them and exploited them. But they incorporated them into their colonies. Now, just for fun, because this is a later question on the test, how does that differ? I mean, they conquer these Indians, they subdue them, they exploit them, but these Indians are part of their colonial, establishments, either as slaves or a controlled population. How does that contrast with the British relationship with the Native Americans? Go ahead.
The British kind of just like throw them off and they really worry about them being involved in what they're doing.
Yeah, I mean, what Morello said, the British killed them off, and I would say that happened frequently, they killed them off. But if they didn't kill them off, what did they do? Push them away. Right? So with Britain, the Indians are not incorporated on any level. They're not enslaved necessarily. They're not incorporated and subdued. The relationship between the natives and the British is the British push them away, right? They either, you say, kill them off, yes, in times they did that, or push them away. In Bacon's Rebellion, remember today we were talking about, what is it?
Troy.
Troy, that's the brother, right? Right, they're not good, not as good looking. Right, not at all, everyone knows that. Right? But Troy, remember we said that in Bacon's Rebellion they were pushing them away, right? The natives to the frontier, and Bacon's rebels went to the frontier. Well, that was the traditional British pattern. Whereas the Spanish, had them somewhat incorporated into their settlements. How about the French? What was the French settlement pattern with the Native Americans? It's different from the Spanish, and it's different from the British. Go ahead, Nevin. Yeah, there was more of an assimilation and a codependence between the Native Americans and the French. What event would you argue marked the decline of British influence in the Western Hemisphere and the beginning of the decline of their empire in general? No, that's a little ahead.
Did you say British or Spanish?
Spanish. What marked the decline of the Spanish Empire? Yeah, go ahead.
The defeat of the Spanish Armada.
You got a year on that?
No, I don't.
Yes, 1588. Now, on the test, you won't be asked for dates, but you will be asked to put things in order chronologically. So it might not be a bad idea to have dates at least roughly associated. Now, when I asked you on the test to put things in order, it won't be like something happened in 1619, 1620, and 1621. The things that I'll ask you to put in order will be remarkably far away from each other. Like I might say, well, what came first? Put in order Columbus's discovery of America and the defeat of the Armada, right? Well, obviously, they're almost 100 years apart, right? So the rough kind of chronological order of things. So it's 1588 when the Spanish Armada is defeated. That marks the kind of decline of the Spanish influence in their empire and the beginning of the rise of the British. Now, I'm looking here and I have a question of which things in order. But let me give you a couple of things that are outside of our conversation, but might be relevant to kind of chronology. One would be Columbus's discovery of America, 1492. Another would be the Protestant Reformation. A year on that, anyone besides the instructor? Anyone besides the instructor? 1570. Another might be Henry's decision to embrace Protestantism and to reject the Pope, and that's 1534. Another might be the Restoration. Oh, incidentally, what was the Restoration? What was the Restoration? Now, that's far into the future, is it not? Right? I mean, if we're talking about 1530, the Restoration was way later than 1530, right? What was the Restoration? Anybody remember? That's far further. Go ahead, Kevin. Tell the kids. Go ahead.
Me?
Yes.
Wasn't it when it was when Charles II came back?
Yes. Charles II, the king, was restored to the throne, 1660. Now, the other things like the foundation of Jamestown in 1607 and the foundation of Plymouth in 1620, you don't necessarily need to know the dates, but you do kind of need to know what came first and what came second, right, and what may have come after. Right? Putting the dates on there might be helpful for that. But, I mean, usually when I ask the question, they're flagrant. They're 50 years apart, right? Okay. We said after 1588, the British possessed the same characteristics that the French possessed at around 1500. And that is they had a unified, idea about religion. They had embraced Protestantism. They had a popular ruler, Elizabeth the First. They had a sense of nationalism. And with these characteristics, they kind of launched their settlements, right? Now, the first permanent settlement in British North America is Jamestown in 1607. Jamestown is financed by a joint stock company, which is a private corporation that we talked about at length. 1607, Jamestown, first permanent British settlement. A private corporation, the Virginia Company, established the Jamestown settlement as a profit-making venture. Right? They wanted to profit by colonization. Remember, we argued they hoped to profit by simply acquiring gold, growing cash crops, or discovering the Northwest Territory. Not Northwest Territory, Northwest Passage. Now, none of those things fully develop until tobacco comes along. And initially, the settlers are going to struggle with starvation and basically taking care of themselves. And remember, we gave multiple reasons why they behaved the way they did. One was there were a lot of gentlemen that didn't believe in kind of working, that were focused on those ways of profiting and didn't take care of themselves. There was internal dissension between them, kind of jockeying for power and position that distracted them. There were other people that were kind of forced to be part of the expedition that they really didn't want to work to provide for themselves. All of these things result in kind of a starving time for the Jamestown settlers. We said the colony is saved by two things. One is the forceful leadership of John Smith in that second terrible winter, where Smith takes over the colony and forces people to work and provide for themselves, and Smith forges a relationship with the Native Americans. The Powhatan Indians, right, and that kind of power play we said, when Powhatan captures Smith and you know, Pocahontas intervenes on Smith's behalf, and we talked about how that may have been a signal from Powhatan that he had the power over Smith and they could destroy them, but they kind of wanted to live in some level of an uneasy peace with them. So we talked a little bit about that, and we said that eventually what really kind of allows the colony to endure is the discovery of tobacco, right? And they don't really discover tobacco necessarily, as they discover that tobacco can be commercially cultivated in Virginia, right? I mean, tobacco had already been known in Europe. The market for tobacco had already been established, right? You know, contact between the natives and the Europeans had introduced tobacco to Europe. But what John Rolfe, and that's R-O-L-F-E, John Rolfe, discovered was that tobacco could be commercially cultivated in Jamestown. And when Rolfe marries Pocahontas in 1614, his marriage to Pocahontas ended the first Anglo-Powhatan War, the first conflict between the Powhatans and the Jamestown settlers, and sets a course for, you know, the colony to grow with tobacco central. Now, I mean, we stretched Virginia out into just recently in talking about their labor force, but we argued that once this colony endures, you know, that more people are going to go there. And they're going to go there primarily desiring to acquire land that they can grow tobacco on, and that's a lucrative cash crop, that many of them hope that they can become wealthy by growing. And some do, right? Some acquire, you know, land, you know, and with that land they grow tobacco, and we talked about the labor needs of those people and eventually slavery, you know, being introduced, and we'll come back to that in a second. I would point out that the Virginia Company is going to ultimately fail, and the king is going to take over the colony, and Virginia becomes a royal colony. Now remember today when we were talking about Governor Berkeley and Governor Berkeley's kind of controversy with Nathaniel Bacon, and Bacon's rebellion. Well, Berkeley was appointed by the king, right? You know, whoever was the king, and Berkeley was there for 30 years, so whoever appointed him, he was there for a considerable amount of time. But the royal governors of these colonies were eventually, they were, you know, appointed by the crown or the representatives. Okay, now when, in your textbook, Maryland and Virginia are discussed together. We did not. We went up to New England and we came back to Maryland. But let's talk about Maryland quickly. What's the most distinctive thing about, I mean, Maryland is very similar to Virginia in climate, topography, you know, plantation, you know, indentured labor, you know, all of those things, Maryland and Virginia are similar. What would be the most fundamental, well, there are two kind of things in our conversation that represented a difference between Maryland and Virginia. Go ahead, Nevin, this is the review session of your life, go ahead.
Maryland was mainly capital.
Yes, Maryland was founded somewhat as a haven for persecuted Catholics. Now, Nevin, I'll correct you on one thing, and you're going to be mad. And that is that I'm not sure that Maryland was ever primarily Catholic, right? I mean, it may have been intended to be primarily Catholic, but it never really was. And what is evidence that Maryland was not primarily Catholic? What was that piece of legislation? That would be on the test. The AP loves it. 1649 piece of legislation. Go ahead, Dominic.
Act of Toleration.
The Act of Toleration. What did the Act of Toleration guarantee, dear Dominic?
Religious freedom in Maryland.
For Christians, right? Religious freedom for anybody that believed in the Trinity in Maryland, which would enfranchise the Catholic minority, right? The other thing to remember about Maryland, it is the first of the proprietary colonies. The other proprietary colonies are going to be Carolina, right? Proprietary colony. New York, proprietary colony. Pennsylvania, proprietary colony. Even New Jersey is an offshoot of New York, is a proprietary colony, at least initially, right? So the proprietary colonies, the first of those is going to be Maryland. And Maryland is a pre-Restoration colony. Restoration is 1660, right? English Civil War is 1640 to 1660. Maryland and Virginia, the Chesapeake colonies, are established prior to the Restoration, prior to the English Civil War, correct? Okay, now. In terms of slavery, because we talked about this today a little bit, and we talked about slavery in Virginia, and we said that slavery in Virginia and Maryland doesn't come until the turn of the century, in large measure. There are slaves before that. We know that the first slaves are introduced into Jamestown in 1619. That's the first kind of documentary evidence we have that there was slavery in the British colonies, 1619. And it was actually John Rolfe's writing where he says that Africans have been brought here, right? You know, in 1619. We know that. But really, the institution of slavery is introduced to colonial America where? Slaves are introduced in Jamestown, but the structural institution of slavery is introduced in colonial America in what colony? Right? So when I say the structural institution of slavery, the laws, the mentality, the slave codes, what colony? Go ahead, Mark.
Was it South Carolina?
Yes. It is the Carolinas, right? And remember, where did the South Carolinians bring the tradition of slavery and the codes associated from slavery from? The Caribbean, and what island in particular is very much connected? Yes.
Barbados.
Barbados. The Barbadian slave codes are the slave codes that are employed eventually in the southern part of Carolina, and they will be the model for Virginia and Maryland eventually. So we talked a little bit about that. We talked about the establishment of the southern part of Carolina. Oh, what did we say the cash crop in those plantations were in the southern part of Carolina? Southern part of Carolina. What did they grow in large measure? Go ahead, Emily. Not Emily. Carly, yes, go ahead.
Rice.
Rice and indigo was grown there on those plantations. And that's when there were a tremendous number of slaves. Because those rice plantations required a lot of labor, skilled labor, where they recruited African slaves that were experienced in cultivating rice to labor on those plantations. Right? Okay, so the rice plantations. Now, how was North Carolina different than the southern part of Carolina? We may mention this. We said they take on a different identity. The southern part of Carolina is plantation-based, slave-based, aristocratic, social stratification. Northern part of Carolina takes on such a different identity that eventually when the king takes over the Carolinas, he formally divides them into two specific colonies. What's the difference between the identities? Yes?
North Carolina consisted of poor people?
Yes, mostly kind of dirt farmers, poorer people, religious, more likely to embrace, less aristocratic, more likely to embrace not necessarily Puritanism or anything like that, or even the Church of England, more independent-minded, less likely to embrace slavery, or even indentured servitude, a different kind of environment than the southern part of Carolina. That's not to say that slaves aren't introduced into North Carolina, they eventually are, but not on the magnitude of South Carolina. Okay. Now, in talking about New England, probably the biggest thing that influenced New England was the rise of Puritanism in Europe. And Puritanism emanates from the Protestant Reformation, which challenged, some of the practices and the authority of the Catholic Church. And that Protestant Reformation comes to England when Henry VIII pulls the Church of England out from the leadership of the Church of Rome, right, the Catholic Church. Now remember, Henry VIII's move was political, right? right? He broke with the Catholic Church because of politics, basically, not necessarily because of religion. But in breaking away and no longer being Catholic, by definition, he was Protestant, right? England is going to grapple with that throughout the 17th, or throughout the, I'm sorry, throughout the 16th century. They will grapple with, you know, the Protestant Reformation. Eventually, it is Elizabeth that firmly establishes England as a Protestant nation. But in doing so, I mean, what she basically solidified was the break with Rome. The question that the Puritans, you know, looked at was how far the Church of England should go in embracing Protestantism. And remember, the Puritans wanted to fully embrace the Protestant Reformation, and they wanted to purify the Church of England from all the vestiges of Catholicism. And one of the vestiges of Catholicism was a pretty strong connection between the church and the monarchs in England. You know, and the Puritans challenged the authority of the Pope or the King to kind of regulate religion on any level. And remember, they talked about the authority of the Bible. And challenging the religious authority of the king was a short step to challenging the political authority of the king. And so Puritans were suspect. Separatists who really want to go all the way are harassed. And that sets the stage, you know, for the establishment of Plymouth and eventually the establishment of Massachusetts Bay. Right? The establishment of Massachusetts Bay is undertaken by Puritans, not separatists. And remember, the Puritans are not going to fully abandon the Church of England as much as they're going to try to reform it. Right? But as things deteriorate in England for the Puritans in their view, they are increasingly, particularly with Charles I, right, they are going to increasingly believe that they can only fulfill their kind of godly covenant in America. And that sets the stage for the establishment of Massachusetts Bay. Massachusetts Bay is a joint stock company. Is that looking at me?
Yeah, you can.
Yes, okay. Is a joint stock company, just like the Virginia Company was a joint stock company. Only their mission was profit and, you know, this city on a hill to show the world. Now, we talked about Massachusetts Bay, and we talked about dissenters from Massachusetts Bay. And who were the two big dissenters that we mentioned that challenged, you know, some of the ideology of Massachusetts Bay? Yes? Roger Williams and Anne Hutchinson. And there's a question about both of them on the test. What would you associate with Williams? I mean, what would you associate with his challenge? I mean, obviously, one thing we would associate with Roger Williams is that his banishment eventually results in the establishment of Rhode Island, right? Williams, because of his banishment, what Williams was at the end of the day was an extreme separatist. He wants to fully separate the governmental authority from the church, right? Even the Puritan church. So he's like an extreme separatist, right? Who challenged, you know, whether the, you know, the land was justifiably owned by, you know the Native, you know, by the settlers there, the Native Americans. So an extreme settler, you know, his ideas were considered relatively dangerous, and so he's forced to flee. And when he does so, he flees south of Massachusetts Bay, and he establishes the colony there of Rhode Island. And Hutchinson is going to follow him eventually. And Hutchinson's challenge was something called antinomianism. Antinomianism means without the law, meaning that. Antinomianism, I don't even know how to spell that. Antinomianism means without the law. Meaning that Hutchinson said, hey, look, if you're saved, right, it doesn't matter what you do, and then it doesn't matter what you do. You don't have to follow any laws, right, in order to be saved. Either you are saved or you're not. And either you're chosen or you're not. And that's what, you know, that's what predestination means. Pure predestination is you're either picked or you're not. Doesn't matter what you do. And remember, Hutchison challenged that the preachers in Massachusetts Bay were preaching that it did matter, right? In a subtle sort of way. And that challenge was considered to be a threat that was enough to get her kicked out, you know, of Massachusetts Bay. And also remember, there's also the question of whether or not it was about gender. What about Connecticut? Who was the founder of Connecticut? Does anybody remember that? The founder of Connecticut. We only mentioned it in passing. The founder of Connecticut. The founder, let's say, of Hartford, Connecticut. Hartford, Connecticut. Not New Haven. The Reverend Thomas Hooker. H-O-O-K-E-R. The Reverend Thomas Hooker. And one thing to note about Hooker is that Hartford and eventually Connecticut in 1638 is going to be the first colony to establish a written constitution. Now, I mean, look, this is something that we kind of like celebrate today, a written constitution. The United States has a written constitution. I mean, we have the Constitution, everyone's always talking about the Constitution. Hey, for heaven's sakes, on the 17th of September, we have Constitution Day. Congress passed a law that social studies teachers have to talk about the Constitution on the 17th of September, which is a Sunday. So I'll be over to your homes, right, or be in prison, right? So, but I guess we'll do it on the 18th to avoid jail. But we consider that written Constitution to be sacred. See, the thing is that Britain didn't have a written Constitution, right? They had a series of precedents and traditions, so they did not have a written constitution. And so Connecticut's written constitution, which was called the Fundamental Orders, like the Fundamental Orders, were Connecticut's written constitution, were considered to be an important precedent. The Fundamental Orders was Connecticut's written constitution, which was considered to be an important precedent. Just like the Mayflower Compact, which the separatists, the pilgrims established, was also considered to be an important precedent. The Mayflower Compact was something that was signed by the people on the Mayflower largely because of accidentally settling outside of the scope of the Virginia Company and having no real legal authority there. But it does provide for those settlers a precedent of self-government. Right? We'll agree to make laws amongst ourselves, and we'll agree to follow them. And that's self-government. And there is a question about the Mayflower Compact on the test as well, so I'm glad I connected that too. There's also a question on the test about King Philip's War. And King Philip's War is the final chapter in Puritan-Indian relations in New England. And the result of King Philip's War, Philip is like Philip, like, hey, Phil, Philip. I mean, it's not an Indian word. And they called, the Puritans called King Philip, you know, which was a, you know, a European name. And he was an Indian leader that leads this rebellion against the Puritans that ends in a very devastating war that basically, extends the supremacy of Europeans over Indians in New England permanently. After King Philip's War, the Indians are no longer going to be a threat to the Puritans in New England. It's a very vicious war. I mean, it's kind of the anti-chapter of Thanksgiving, yes. He is a Native American, but his name is spelled like Philip, right? You know. Now, we talked about the southern colonies, we talked about New England, and now the middle colonies. What's significant about the establishment of New York? What's the most, I mean, the whole narrative of New York. Yeah, go ahead. Don't call me yet, Dan. Out of nowhere. Unbelievable, isn't it, Dan? That I got that. Unbelievable. Go ahead.
The Spanish originally held it, then they got word that the British were going to come and fight them for it.
Not the Spanish.
Or the French.
Not the French.
Dutch.
The Dutch. We don't have anybody up there. It's the Dutch, right? Remember, this is an area that was colonized by the Dutch prior to the British acquiring it. And the Dutch had the New Netherlands, an established colony. They had trade with the Native Americans, and the British just took it. Right? So James II, the brother of Charles II, took the possession from them, claimed it for their own, secured it for Britain. The Dutch were kind of helpless to defend it. Nobody wanted to fight for it, and Britain took it over. You know, one of the characteristics of that colony was the multicultural nature of it. You know, there was such diversity there. And we said that was true of Pennsylvania as well. You know, that both Pennsylvania and New York were diverse. And that's the most distinguishing factor of the middle colonies in general, ethnic and religious and racial diversity, right, in the middle colonies. And remember, we also said that kind of made them American, you know, in a sense. Now, we talked about the settlement of Pennsylvania, and in doing so, we talked about Penn and him being a Quaker. Probably should have some familiarity with some of the characteristics of the Quakers, one of which being that the Quakers believed that anybody could be saved, right? The Quakers did not believe in military service, swearing oaths, and would not recognize traditional deference. And in doing so, being unwilling to swear allegiance, serve in the military, and recognize deference, they were considered threatening to the stability of British society, and that's why they were persecuted on some level. Yes, that doesn't make sense to us, but it made perfect sense to them. Now, we talked about Penn and his vision, and we said that Pennsylvania is going to prosper because of a confluence of a lot of different things. It's good land, there is easy transportation, you know, it's one of the last settlements, so it benefits from other settlements that have been established there. But Penn's ideas and the laws that he made and the advertising that he does also contributes to it, right? And one of the things that's characteristic of Pennsylvania is very amicable Indian relations, more so than any of the other colonies, which results in more prosperity. In New England, they are still fighting the Native Americans in the late 1600s. That's King Philip's War. In the South, they're still fighting the Powhatan Wars in the 1670s. And that's going to retard settlement and expansion, right? You know, in the middle colonies, particularly in Pennsylvania, this kind of warfare isn't slowing up development, right? You know, so the amicable Indian relations are important in Pennsylvania. Now, we over the last couple of days, and this will wrap it up for us, we've been talking about, you know, regional characteristics, right? So we divided, you know, colonial, you know, America into the southern colonies, we divided into the middle colonies, we talked about the middle colonies, and we divided into New England. And in terms of the southern colonies, we said one of the things that was distinctive, particularly in the 17th century, was the disease-ridden nature of the colonies and how that affected family life. That there wasn't much family life in the South because everybody died so quickly, right? And that marriages and, you know, the number of women and, you know, resulted in kind of an individualistic, profit-motivated culture. We contrasted that with the long life of New England, which emphasized family. And that family life in New England with generations of people supporting, you know, families, grandparents and parents, children, high birth rates in New England, low disease, we contrasted that with the Chesapeake. We also argued that the Chesapeake region, you know, had a labor problem. And over the past couple of days, we've been talking about how they addressed that labor problem. First with indentured servants, and later with slaves. And we talked today about that transformation. And we talked today about Bacon's Rebellion. What did we say was the genesis of Bacon's Rebellion? What did we say was the genesis of Bacon's Rebellion? I mean, what was it all about? Like, we're going to pick one thing from the narrative to say what it was about. What would you say? Yeah, go ahead, Wes.
Indentured servants not getting their payoff.
Yeah, indentured servants not getting their payoffs. Well, what were they mad at the governor most about? Not getting their payoffs, but they were most mad about, yes? Yes, Indians, right? That when they pushed the frontier to get their land, they ran into the Native Americans, and the governor would not support their efforts to subdue them. You know, wouldn't send the militia, wouldn't finance their efforts to push the Indians further or destroy them. Right? And they didn't like that, and they wanted that land. And they were susceptible to Bacon's kind of appeal to them. And Bacon, on some level, was considered to be a demagogue, somebody that takes advantage of the disgruntled majority for his own kind of prosperity. And that may have been Bacon, right? Maybe he was a genuine leader. There's a lot of debate. You can't believe how much is written about Bacon's Rebellion. What was one of the effects, though, of Bacon's Rebellion that we talked about today? One of the effects of Bacon's Rebellion, right? I mean, we talked about this a little bit today. Do you remember? Yeah, go ahead.
The rich got more, pardon me? The wealthy got more wealthy, and the poor got less poor, or more poor.
Yeah, I mean, what Dan said is the wealthy got wealthier and the poor got poorer amongst the white majority, right? So amongst the white majority, the wealthier got wealthier and the poor got poorer. Go ahead, Weiss, say something else. It facilitates the transformation from white indentured service to slavery. And it also solidifies an alliance amongst white people. Right? Look, after Bacon's Rebellion, that elite majority realizes they need the white, or that elite minority realizes they need the white majority if they're going to embrace slavery to keep that slave population under control. Okay. Now, we talked a little bit about the differences between indentured servants and slaves, and we did say that indentured servants were people who had sold themselves into slavery for a period of time, and we talked about the advantages and the disadvantages of each. Now, the other thing that's going to be on the test is a little bit about the Middle Passage, right? The Africans, you know, coming over from you know, the Middle Passage, the horrors that we talked about today of the Middle Passage, the slave trade, the difficulty there. You know, now we said the expansion of that slave trade in the 18th century is going to result in a reduction in the price of slaves. It's going to contribute pretty greatly to the embracement of slavery as an alternative to white indentured servitude. Okay? All right. One last thing. There is something in your book, and this is kind of probably the only thing that's on the test that I might not have talked about directly. Now, when I say might not, I mean, there could be wrong answers that I didn't talk about, right? You know, so when I say, well, you didn't talk about this wrong answer, you didn't talk about this. What's the wrong answer? That's why I didn't talk about it, right? You know, so, but one general topic that I didn't talk about in class that would be on the test is something called the halfway covenant. The halfway covenant is halfway covenant. And it's at the very end of chapter 4 in your textbook. And the halfway covenant was a means of expanding church membership in Puritan New England. Now, we talked about the importance of the Puritan Congregational Church, and the Puritan Church was called the Congregational Church. And we talked about how they were democratic in their nature. In other words, the members of the church governed the church. They hired the ministers. They were autonomous. Right? There was no church hierarchy. Every church was its own in every village. Now, the members of the church governed the church. The members of the church, right, governed the colony. And the members of the church were those who could prove that they were saved. The halfway covenant was a way for the children of the saved to get church membership without really proving it, without really having a provable conversion experience, right? So I'll say it again. The original settlers in Massachusetts Bay to be church members and to participate in government on the colonial level had to prove that they were saved. Later, the halfway covenant allowed the children of those people to become church members without proving their salvation. And so they were like, halfway there, get it? The halfway covenant, right? You know, so it allowed church membership to remain robust. Now, well, that's good for you. There's also a question on the test about the Pueblo Rebellion. Right? And that was, you know, part of the Spanish experience. And we did talk about this. The Pueblo Rebellion, the Pope's Rebellion. And that was in Santa Fe, New Mexico. So you might want to take a peek at that. And I think that, whoa, holy cow. I think that pretty much covers all the things that were on the test. Sorry I kept you, I didn't know it was that way. And we did a thorough job. Where is it?
Can we just finally call it or something?
I don't miss chemistry. I miss the people in the class in the future.
Oh,
thanks, Gary. That makes me really good.
I didn't say it.
Yeah,
that's
sure. You definitely just didn't say it, did you?
I did say it, but I meant it.